Am I on?
There we go. Jeez.
Hey, Artie.
Lenny, wait. Well, I got to introduce you. You ready?
Okay, yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next guy has a book out, and he's getting more pussy than God. Lenny, let me say, congratulations on being number one on the New York Times bestsellers list, Bill O'Reilly. Welcome to the show.
Killing
Reagan. Of course, Lenny Dykstra. Lenny Dykstra, man, I love you. People say the podcast I did with you, one of the funniest ever, and you're amazing.
It was, dude. Yeah. Dude, and you know what pussy you got? I got from that?
We're out
I
of mean, time.
No.
You know how much pussy, you know how much pussy I got from it? You know how much cock Dan got from it?
Hey, well,
I got it.
Listen, though, man. Real quick, I got to get this out there.
Go right ahead.
So they made a press release for me today.
Right.
So what I'm doing is I'm now the spokesman and partner for a company called Rebound Finance. And you kind of get what that means, Rebound Finance.
Dennis Rodman has a mortgage company?
You mean you're on the rebound? Meaning, so like
right.
Did I desire to be like the spokesperson for people that can't get loans and have bad credit? Not really. But guess what, though?
Yeah.
I can help. So tell your people to go to Rebound Finance.
Of course, guys.
And we can fund them. We can fund them. We can give people
my black
that
fans.
Have bad credit loans.
My black fans. Well, listen, you are one of those guys. Most guys who lost their teeth in prison can't get loans. A guard hit you in the face so hard, right, and you knocked out your teeth.
So you
could give better blowjobs.
Speaking of that, though, tomorrow is the big fucking day. I've been working 24/7.
Say go to mile.
To file tomorrow, I'm filing my summary judgment motion. This has been 3 years in the making, and tomorrow's it. The game is fucking on, and then, dude. So I'm going to take apart the fucking L.A. fucking county sheriff piece by fucking piece.
Well,
dude.
We only have time for one plug. Do you want it to be this or the book?
No, this. No.
You're filing your motion.
I'm on to the next deal, dude. The book. I'm talking about Rebound Finance. I mean, look, last time it was about helping women. Now it's about helping people.
Rebound Finance. Now, the guy you were with from the book company last time, at what point did you kill him? Where's the bird? At what point did you roll him for his money?
Well, no,
he was a little flimsy.
I tried to get him laid. He just
I couldn't crack him. He seemed like a lefty.
No. He's an editor. I mean,
exactly.
You know,
that's right.
one of the greatest fucking stories ever. I couldn't tell until the book came out.
Uh-huh.
But so one day, I'm busy my editor. I have to go do an update. And it's a fucking big building, and you got to go through security, and they give you the name tag, you know, and you got to put it on your chest. So I take my name tag, and I put it on my dick, okay?
Because you're a fun
guy. So I put it right on my dick, and I go up there, and I walk into the fucking HarperCollins with 3,000 people in there, and the two receptionists are looking at me kind of laughing. And then what happens is some security dude sees me, he doesn't know who I am. And he fucking kind of pushes me towards the elevator and says, "You're fucking out of here."
Oh, that's
so we get great. In the elevator. We get this true story. We get in the elevator.
I believe it.
Area. And we get in the elevator area, and I say, "Hey, dude, you're easy, man." And he says, "You're fucking out of here." So I spun him around. And I fucking pinned him against the wall, and I said, "Look at me, motherfucker. I will fucking kick your fucking ass in front of every fucking one of your fucking fellow employees. You hear me?" I said, because he panicked because I had him in a fucking pin. So he turns out he's a former cop. So this motherfucker says, he says, "I'll put a bullet in your fucking head."
Okay, there you go. That's great.
I said, whoa, wait.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Whoa. I said, "Wait a second." I said, "No, you don't have to do that."
No, that's out of line.
We'll go down the elevator, mano y mano, and we'll go get it on.
Oh, okay.
And
you're gonna fuck?
You know, he don't want to do that. He don't want to do that. Then he's panicking. I said, "But wait, we're on camera right here. The camera's in the elevator. You'll put a bullet in my head? You're gonna kill me. You're gonna fucking kill me." So now I go down to my editor, who you met, and I say, "Peter, I'm sorry I'm a little late, but we had a little problem. You know, I was waiting to get in to see you, and your security's obviously tightened up over at HarperCollins."
Yeah, they're not alone.
"Because your security guy threatened to fucking kill me." I said, he says, "What?" I said, yeah, he told me he's going to put a bullet in my fucking head.
That's ridiculous.
And I said, so you know what, Peter? I said, I'm done, man. So I'm down. He's, where are you? Where are you? Where are you? I said, I'm downstairs smoking a cigarette.
I'm the one with the and my name stapled to my dick.
Hey, dude, you're going to love this. So. And so Peter comes down. I said, Peter, don't say a word. All you got to do to fix this, and we'll go on, is you got to call that motherfucker, and you got to tell him to meet me at the fucking corner of so-and-so and so-and-so. And my guy Peter's panicking, dude. He's
meet
like,
me at the corner of
I'm a fucking editor. I'm an editor.
Meet me at the corner of crazy and schizophrenic.
Yeah, I mean, whatever the corner around the corner is. And I said, we can settle this mano-a-mano, and I'll sign a waiver. I said, but Peter, that's what you need to do. And he says, I'm an editor. So this is the greatest story ever. So then I said, you know what? Fuck it. I said, you know, it still went on and on and on. I ended up signing the book for the guy. The guy turned out to be cool.
That's great.
He was a cop. He was a former cop.
Right.
And what happened was he, you know, when you pin someone against a wall and they can't move, they panic.
They try to shoot.
Yeah, and plus what I'm saying, I'm looking right in his face, and I said, you're getting old, motherfucker. You're getting fucking old.
Right. I know, my God. Now,
and
he went out.
And I said to him, I said, I'll kick your fucking ass in front of every one of your fucking employees.
That's amazing.
I said, yeah, so that's my story there.
That's great, man. Do you realize the reason that guy talked to him, the reason that editor was a little, he was crazy, because the other guy, the other person he had a book out with was Gianna De Laurentiis, and she doesn't do that a lot. You don't get that a lot with Gianna De Laurentiis.
But, I mean, look, I got to take a little bit of responsibility.
You're unbelievable.
I did put the thing on my dick.
You know what? I'll give you, like, next dick. Time you do that, when you put it on your dick, here's you should do this. Big laughs. Sometimes you want to go where everybody blows your name. Blows your name.
Hey, listen.
You stapled it? Did you pin it to your dick?
No. It's a sticker thing. You know, the name tag they give you? Because when you go on the big high, the big corporate buildings, all the corporate bullshit and all the bean counters and all the fucking... God, what a torturous life that is.
Right. No, I know.
Fuck. I mean that's almost like the 85% of the people that fucking... Ready? Husband gets up, gets in his car, fights traffic, goes take fucking... orders at his miserable job, goes back home, eats his shitty wife's food.
Exactly.
They don't fuck, and he gets up in the morning and do it all over again.
I know, they do. They do. You're right.
And that's how they live, and next thing you know, they roll a 7, and people walk, he's a good guy, and party's over.
I know.
The
people who don't lose their teeth in prison.
Hey, listen,
me and you figured it out. Me and you, Lenny, we figured it out. You're right. We have a skill, and we took a risk, and we went out in the world, and we used that skill, and we prospered, and eventually I'm on a couch, and you're working for Rebound Finance.
Hey, Artie.
What?
I have taken these fucking women to a place they've never been, bro.
Yeah, you're trying.
It's a space shuttle, dude.
Your kitchen.
No, they literally, they can't take it.
Really? The place where they're high school?
So, no, my attorney said I have to start telling them, like, full disclosure, because I'm becoming habits forming.
Well, what's your full disclosure? What do you have to tell them?
That they're going to start doing things they normally wouldn't do, like
what, from
calling me up and saying... No, yeah, saying, hey, meet me behind the parking lot of Home Depot.
What?
Because once I take them to that place, Artie, listen, once
the
I take them to
Home
that
Depot?
They want to go. No, that place, dude, the space shuttle.
Has a girl ever found your name sticker in her pussy?
No. No, but Artie, I'm a technician, though, bro.
Imagine Planned Parenthood. Why does there a sticker says
I'm
Lenny?
I'm a technician. No, I'm a technician.
You're a technician.
Dude.
What do you do?
It's about precision and accuracy,
like
bro.
Like you played ball.
Yeah, but see, the thing is, see, before I can do my artwork, the canvas has got to be clean, okay?
Shaved.
The canvas has got to be clean.
Waxed.
Okay.
Now does that?
No, just clean. No, just showered
up. Do you like a white background?
No,
black
background. No. Once in a while, nah, like whatever. Hey, the bottom line though, once in a while, I got this one person. She's about 77, and she's got a fucking.
Seventy-seven years old.
She's got a fucking Artie. She's got a she's got a fucking fetish about reliving her fucking prom days.
Right. Well, that was before cars.
No, you talk about
cars.
You want to talk about bad, bro? Like, no matter how fucked up you've ever been and how fucked up I've ever been.
Right.
Having to put your fucking tongue down the throat of a fucking 77-year-old,
that
fucking hurt, dude.
I haven't done this since my grandfather.
That fucking...
Grandpa Sandusky.
Hey, by the way, only Artie fucking Lane could have me on a podcast at fucking 1:30 in the morning in New York.
What does that say about both of us?
I just love it.
I love it. I know. Where are you now?
Well, I'm in Beverly Hills.
Uh-huh. Oh, God.
I'm smoking a cigarette.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for, whose turn is it tonight? let me see.
Are you waiting for a senior citizen meeting together?
No. Tonight's the middle of the road one that...
Get out of here.
It's just, yeah. In fact, last time she was here, she fell asleep with my dick in her mouth.
There's a rumor you're dating Maya Bialik. Is that true?
I swear to fucking God she did, dude.
Wait, this girl, the 77-year-old, fell asleep with your dick in her mouth?
No, it's another one. The 77, that's a client.
Now, do you come...
Look, here she is. Here she is. Look,
you're like Richard Gere?
Here she is. Hold on. Here she is. What?
I can't hear her.
Hello?
Hey, I'm outside.
You're outside? Uh-huh. Okay, I'll let you in.
That sounded like gold in my ear.
How old was that woman? You think that was planned?
I don't think you planned anything, no.
How could I stage that when you guys are an hour late on calling me?
3 hours.
Meaning, the bottom line is we're both above ground.
Give him Jeff Garland's address.
hey, the Mets did a nice job, huh? Nice play.
About that? You must love it. Because if you were on that team, dude, you'd have taken your dick out of Keith Hernandez's mouth. And went out and got a double, a game-winning double. Did anyone ever? Did anybody else? Dwight could never fall asleep with someone's his cock.
No, hey, look.
You can't do that on blow.
I had no idea he was on the Yale, man. No idea.
No idea. Why would you?
No, I swear to God.
He had a white mustache.
I swear to God. No, because he was so young. I think
you can't
I don't
tell
know.
A black. You can't tell a black guy snorting coke. I mean,
but see, I didn't know anything about that shit, dude. No.
What about?
Here's the deal.
What?
About the blow and all that shit, dude. I was just a kid, man. I was living the dream.
It said in the book you were doing it all your career.
No, in the 90s, yeah. Not in the Mets. But I mean... I was a kid.
When you got a ring, the team you got a ring...
Yeah, I went to the 90s, and I went to the Phillies, I was the leader, and I kind of took it to the next level, you know?
Right. Were you on the 90s? You were on the 93 Phillies, right, who lost to the Jays?
Fuck, yeah. 93 Phillies? Yeah, let me tell you what I did. Because I want you to know. Because there's only one player in the history of baseball. Because that's a big fucking statement. History of baseball, we're going hundreds of years, right? Hundreds. Lou Gehrig, Ty Cobb.
800 years.
There's only been one left-handed hitter. One.
Right.
That's went to the plate more times than any other left-handed hitter in the history of baseball.
Right.
And you know who that is? This little broken down white guy over here in Beverly Hills.
You're with Pete Rose?
Me, only. I'm
no,
the
I know. Dude, you were
one.
You had an amazing career. Lenny, you
well,
had
when
an
I wanted. No, only when I needed it. I already see my, they figured me out. I'd get my fucking contract. Right. I'd get my 3-year contract.
Did you hear Vince Scully?
Then I'd party for two years.
Did you hear Vince Scully sign off? He said, and now I'm working for Rebound Finance. I'm going to retire. My regional manager, Lenny Dykstra.
Rebound Finance, bro? Hey, listen. Dude, we're going to help. I'm going to help fucking Americans.
I know, but what is their slogan? Our spokesperson just had his cock in someone's mouth and they fell asleep?
No, but listen. Rebound Finance, dude, gives people a chance to fucking a second chance, you know, when your credit's bad.
What about getting...
No, dude. If you got bad credit, they look at you like you got a fucking disease.
You should go to Rebound Dentist.
Oh, yeah. Well, no, I got teeth, bro.
Now, why are they... Where are they?
But, I can't...
Take them out.
It affects my fucking... That's one of my secrets, bro. Hey, like, they don't know that.
That was the reason that they figured you were an athlete, so, you know, a lot of black guys with bad credit or something?
Yeah. Oh, no. Because, bad credit, dude. Right. If they can give me a fucking loan, they can give everybody a loan.
Do you have Jesse Orozco's number?
Who?
Jesse Orozco. Have you talked to him lately?
Oh, yeah. Jesse, yeah.
I heard he was a $3 bill.
Hey, what about, let's conference in my boy Doc.
Doc Goodman? I'll call.
Yeah.
I'll call. As a matter of fact, I'm going to meet him at a delivery I'm making. I love you.
Hey, Artie, listen. You know why? Penis.
How long is it taking this woman to get in the elevator?
You know what? She's in. She's upstairs. She's getting surgery. No, I make him take a shower first.
Now what is she?
Hey, Artie,
what do you do with the prosthetic leg?
Hey, do you know why? Do you know why a penis or a dick has such a tough life in this world?
Why?
It has a head with no brains. It has one eye. It lives with two nuts.
Sammy Davis.
It has an asshole for a neighbor. And its best friend's a cunt.
I love it. Who told you that joke?
I'm coming to New York, bro.
You got to come stay with us. Can you stay with us?
I'm coming. No, I'm cool. Me and you are going to fucking do. We're gonna light up the fucking city.
Can
brother.
You take me to that place where you take the broods?
Oh my! Hey!
Is it a chiropractor?
Listen. All right, it's all about. Look, there she is up
Give
there.
Jeff
look,
Garland,
there
Jeff.
She is. There she is. She's looking out
is she
the window.
Here now? Is she finally here? Looking out the window.
Yeah. No. Look, she's doing.
Did the window have bars?
No, she's cleaning the canvas. The canvas is getting cleaned.
She's shaving in front of you?
No, the canvas. You got to clean the.
She's,
you got to take a shower. You got to clean.
She's in the shower.
No, the canvas. I can't do my artwork if the canvas is.
No, wait a minute. You're at your place. Are you at your place?
Or, it's a fucking mansion, man.
You're in a mansion?
I live in the back of my friend's place, man.
I'm going to say it's somebody else's place.
So, of course, somebody else's place.
Well, who's your best friend? Johnny Galecki?
You know my best friend is, dude.
It sounds like this bro in the shower.
No, I'm dude.
What about some of the guys? Is Wally Backman coming over to double team this chick?
No, Wally Backman, he's I don't know, he quit or something.
You JSL. Well, good.
The bottom line is this, dude.
What?
Is at the end of the day, what's it come down to? Having something to look forward to.
Exactly.
Hope.
Like a phone call ending? What?
Yeah, see, I can't already see my deal now. It's like, I can't even come, dude. It's just a process.
That's disappointing. I thought you were taking
Is that how you take them to places? No, what I do, though, I told you I had a Jewish doctor did my circumcision. And the chicks, like they love looking at my... It's not a monster, by the way.
Yeah.
But it's like, they say, wow.
How big is your dick? How big? Totally around.
No, it's just average.
How big is your dick?
But no, it's just average, but my Jewish doctor...
Did you ever shower next to her? He carved
it up good, bro.
What?
So they call this PC, the perfect cut, see? Yeah. I'm performing, but see, I'm more of a finesse player now. Remember that as you get older.
Let's go do a set of flappers.
Wait, so hey, listen, on 21st, I'm coming to New York. All right, we're going to dinner.
I'm in, dude. I'm in.
And okay, you're in, and bring your man with you too, right?
I will. Well, my life partner.
Okay. Yeah, your man. He's awesome. And then listen.
Find the editor.
So what do you want, man? Here's where we're going.
I like him low and loose, man. Low and loose.
We're going to Vivid. We're going to Vivid. My buddy owns it. We're going to Vivid.
I like Puerto Rican chicks. I like Puerto Rican chicks with tattoos of their dead brother on their neck.
Yeah, just be careful with the. Yeah, there you go. Hey, be careful with them Colombians, though. Hey, the Colombians, they're fucking mean.
I know. They're fucking mean, dude. Yeah.
You talking about the girls? They got some canned heat rigs, though.
What?
You know, I just have these two. I just canned heat.
You know what I like? You know what I like? Pablo Open Bar.
Hey, you know, dude. I hooked up with these two fucking Koreans. They're 21.
Yeah. Let me conference with Bob Costas.
It's just the craziest thing I've ever seen.
What are two Koreans?
I'm not even. I don't even go down the fucking. I don't even go down the fucking. You know, I'm not an Asian type.
You like black broads?
Not really, because it's kind of. Well, I heard when they come, it's like ooh 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 ooh.
What? Are you making a chimp noise? Rebound Finance is not going to like this.
Hey, Rebound Finance, dude.
The Sprite people called.
Dude, we're giving people hope, brother.
You really are. You are.
It's all about hope. Because without hope, you got nothing.
Yeah, I agree with you. I agree with you.
You know, that's why I ended my book on my book. I wrote my book. And I said, like, how am I going to I found God. I found there's. No, I haven't found God. Like, I'm looking. Come on, motherfucker.
You stop looking as well.
Where are you? Come on now. I'm waiting.
That's how you're looking for God?
Well, I don't know. That's what I said, so I couldn't end it like that. So I said, I think the best way for me to end this book is three words. To be continued.
Right. What's the best way to end this call?
The best way to end this call?
No, I'm kidding. Well, now, wait, is the chick
here's
chatting?
Is
the chick loofing? Is she using a loofah, this chick? What is she doing?
Oh, no. Now she's waiting.
Is she shoving your gold glove of her upper twat?
No. She's taking a shower. Now she's waiting for me. Right. To perform my I'm like fucking Picasso, bro.
How depressing would it be if the chick's Mookie Wilson?
wait, what's that?
I wanna I'm gonna want something else to roll through your legs, honey.
Hey, Ari, last time we did your show, man, fucking we blew up good, bro. Good fucking good response.
You're right. Since I did that show, you're right. I've lost two endorsements.
No. No, dude, fucking
big. He needs rebound
bro. You're big.
I'm big.
No, you're big. You're.
Well,
dude,
everybody.
Dude, I have so many fucking likes on that shit. People
do you mind
sending me shit.
Well, listen, do you mind if I put down, if you be a guest on my show, you'll get a deal with Rebound Finance?
Yeah. Okay. Hey.
I think we'll get, because we're trying to get Emma Stone.
Come on, man. You gotta blow up Rebound Finance.
I'll do whatever you want, Vinny. I got
it. We're going to help people,
we have
bro.
To go out. Dude, don't go back on this promise. We're going to go out
the
to dinner.
The 21st.
Yep.
21st.
Let me check my schedule. Oh, I'm busy doing...
Schedule.
It says here I'm busy doing anything else.
21st, dude. We're locked in. We're going to be going to Vivid.
I can't wait. Now, you want Vivid?
Dude.
What about Scores? I'm hooked up at Scores, dude.
No,
I'm talking to a Stern
dude,
guy, dude.
I know you. I know I am.
Fuck Scores. You're right. Fuck it.
Yeah. No, go to Vivid because I'm my boy there. And the thing about it is, you know, there's certain doors that open for me there that other people don't go in.
Well, last time I was at Vivid, two of the chicks joined ISIS after they gave me a lap dance. They started a fatwa with my cock.
Hey, Ari.
That's me.
Are you getting a lot of pussy right now or what?
Dude, I'm fucking a chick right now. Let me take the tape off her mouth.
Wait.
You know what? I'm fucking Mariano Rivera's wife.
Do you have a coat on though? Do you have a coat on?
No, I go bareback. This is Mariano Rivera's wife. She can't have any more kids.
Oh fuck! I like it.
I'm kidding. I wouldn't fucking.
No, I can't put a coat on, dude.
Why?
Because TC doesn't deserve to be fucking blocked, called blocked up like that.
You don't want a half Asian chick coming to you going, hey, you
kidding? Oh, no, but no, I don't enter. No, I don't enter. I told you that before. You have to earn that shit.
What do you do? What do you fuck? You don't earn
that? No. I have a tongue depressors, and I check their mouths because
this?
I'm a non-man.
Dr. Dykstra?
No, because I have to make sure there's no sores, because if they're PC, we can't ever put them at risk.
Of course, because, I mean, that's not too depressing.
Yeah, so what happens
when I come
is,
to L.A., we're going to get two tickets to Flappers to see Jeff Garland.
Wherever you want to do, bro.
I got it in.
Hey, listen.
Do you like ironic comedy?
You give me a fucking hour's notice, I'm in.
All you need is an hour?
That's all I need for you, brother. All I need.
You want to go to Largo? I hear David Cross is doing a one-man show.
Wherever you want to go, dude. I'll take you to where I go every fucking night, the intersection of heaven and hell.
Where do you find these broads? Because I used to live in L.A., and my coke dealer used to get hookers, but they were hot.
No hookers, dude.
What do you call this chick you're with?
Understand something, dude. The day I pay a fucking girl a dime is the day I'm a fucking ballerina dancer. You hear me?
I noticed that when we went out. The editor, paid.
I fucking dime. They pay fucking me, bro.
Look at the size of this guy's stomach on this finance. Wait, Rebound Finance. This is Geico.
Hey, look at that fucking. Look at the lad, dude. Artie. Look at the boy.
Hey, listen.
Look at that fucking arm, dude.
Are you checking her? Like Peter Ustinov checking slaves in Spartacus? As go the teeth, go the bones. This woman is made of chalk.
No, seriously. Hey, are you on the site, though? You see that fucking thunder I'm bringing to the party?
Thunder? Well, no. Yeah. You're Hurricane
pipes.
Matthew, baby.
Look at those pipes, bro.
What are you looking at?
See those pipes?
Are you with Floyd Mayweather? Look at those pipes.
No, look at the thunder,
hey,
dude.
Manny Faggy, what are you doing over
there? No, what I'm talking about, dude, that's all drug driven, dude.
Drug driven? Is she on the roids?
That's steroids.
You're even dating a chick on the roids? I mean, come on.
No, dude.
Dude, punch her.
I like feminine. I like very feminine girls. I like soft.
Did you answer a nomatch.com looking for ex-baseball player?
Who's that?
No teeth. Ex-Philly, no teeth. What? Good conversation.
Oh, dude, I don't know. Dude, you don't understand. The word's out, dude. The word's it's already moving up the coast all the way up to fucking Frisco.
What, Hurricane Matthew?
About me. About my R word.
About so the chicks are talking. In other words, girls are talking that Lenny Dykstra can lick a fucking twat. By the way, Sam Champion.
It's not wicked. It's not wicked, dude. It's Sam real Champion artwork. It's a real painting, dude. I put a fucking frame around it when I'm done.
You light them on fire? You can't do that. You're gonna get arrested.
Wait, what?
Don't light them on fire. I mean, is that a metaphor of the flame thing?
No. I said when I'm done, I put a frame around it.
Are you a New York metaphor? I get it. Metaphor. Well, look at it. Google it.
I'm not that smart, do you remember?
That's when when like a Spanish manager goes, what's a metaphor? We don't need a metaphor. We need a Yankee.
Hey, Artie, listen.
What?
But if you go out with me, dude, there's probably a good chance you're going to get fucking late. There's probably a good chance you're going to get late.
Really?
And it's probably another good chance you're probably going to have the best time of your life.
If I go out with $300, I'll get late.
Hey, by the way.
What?
By the way.
BTW.
Let's make some money together, brother.
I got mine.
I know. Okay, let's make some together.
Rebound Finance.
There you go. You were going to say it.
We'll bring it back to that, man. We'll bring it back to that. Hello?
Yeah, you're awesome.
Lenny, I love you. Lenny, you better keep your promise for the 21st.
Okay, hey, dude.
I want to go, dude. You know how bad I want to go hang out with you. We'll hang out.
Okay,
we'll have fun.
We're gonna do it. Have fucking dinner.
And it's on me, dude. It's on me. We're gonna hang out at the upper Bill Bruckner.
It ain't on you, Artie. No,
it is on
you.
Me. I'm gonna buy. And
doing?
Bring the Rebound Finance guys. I want to try to impress them.
Okay, seriously, can I?
Yeah, bring those guys. They sound like great guys.
They're all Canadian, dude. They're cool as fuck.
I know they're Canadian, without knowing.
Yeah,
I guess that was my first guess.
Well, listen. So listen, next time you want me on, give me 10 minutes.
You got an open. You got an open invite, dude. Anytime you want to come on, it sounds like you're in the barrio of L.A. Where are you?
You guys are awesome. I just gotta.
Can I say something can I say something to your date? Feliz Navidad. Can I just say that to her?
Talk to me.
Feliz Navidad.
Talk to me.
Merry Christmas. And la trabajo.
Here he says, Feliz Navidad.
Punta.
Say hi.
Hi.
Say hi. This is Artie Lang here, the badass.
That's right.
Yeah.
Sweetie, do you need any help?
I gotta put you on speaker, dude. You're crazy.
How was the shower?
You're crazy, dude. Like an Artie, man. You take me places I never should go, dude.
Yeah, well, that's a car wash, apparently. Now let's go do something. At 20. Can you bring this chick or another chick? Do you fly these broads places?
Oh no.
What kind of budget? Gosh, have?
No, dude, no.
I love you.
They and my boys put them on notice of coming in.
I love you.
It's a flocking, dude.
Now, is it true David Johnson has to scrape your cum out of his zits, marks?
David Johnson, what's true about David Johnson? He's fucking dismantled an organization.
He's running for president. Didn't know where Aleppo was.
It's a fucking joke. Dude. I mean, no one wants to hear it, but I'm telling you what it did.
What about the politics, Lenny? You ask your date, Trump or Clinton.
Dude.
What do you think about it?
Well, we got the Wicked Witch of the East.
Exactly.
Who's killed what, 46 people?
Yeah.
I mean, wait, all you got, just go to Clinton body count. No, I don't believe me. Wait, don't believe me. Go there. Go to the Clinton body count.
I believe you.
You don't have to believe me. They're not missing. They're not gone. They're fucking dead.
Whoever gets in their way. Did you hear? First of all, I'll tell you what. What in Tennessee? Same thing Arkansas, baby. You understand what I'm saying?
Well, you know, your boy Clinton had a whole system, dude. He'd have the officers. They'd pull him over for a ticket, and he'd say, listen, I'll waive the ticket if you want to come in and give my boy head. So he got more head. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I know.
So, but can you imagine waking up next to Hillary? Oh, my God.
Oh, God, you're right. I mean, Lincoln's going to come to life in the Lincoln bedroom and fucking throw up.
Yeah, but, you know, politics. There's no politics.
Let me tell you something, man. I don't like it. You know, I'm going to say something every man's afraid to say. I don't want a broad to be president. It's really sad. Your thoughts?
It is, too.
They don't have the temperament. They don't think Trump has a temperament. Are you kidding me? Women are irrational. You go out with a woman, you do an 8-ball, have 11 shots of wild turkey, she wants your car keys.
What happened to the days when a woman was supposed to clean the house, cook the food, and fuck their husband?
Amen.
What happened?
Yeah. What happened to those days? I don't want her fucking pressing the button. I want her sewing
clean
the button.
Clean the house. Clean the house, cook the food.
I don't want that. That is the slogan. I don't want her pressing the button. I want her sewing the button. No, I'll press.
All right,
the
man.
Button.
Listen, man.
I'll press the
listen,
button. He's actually annoyed with me. All right, buddy.
Hey, listen,
you go take that. Cause I could hear her getting bored. Go take her out.
Yeah, no, not bored. No, not bored.
Do you have an or? Do you have a digit inside her right now? Are you keeping her happy? You keeping her happy?
No, not yet, because
is she in that place she's never been before?
Not yet, but it's a very... It's
I got a feeling that place is not LA County.
It's a very...
You're in LA County. I said a place I've never been.
You got good wit, dude. You're a pretty smart motherfucker. You know that, dude.
Tell that to the head of HBO.
Hey, nice job by the Mets.
They suck. They need
Collins.
Lenny Dykstra. They need, shout out for the mountain. Terry Collins.
Oh, I can't take it, man.
Johnson.
It's like Xanax. Take a Xanax before you watch them, dude.
Oh, I know. And the Dominicans, your thoughts?
I mean, the bottom line is at the end of the day, dude, it comes down to this. Are you a winning player or are you a losing player?
Are you fucking black?
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah, I mean, the bottom line is at the end of the day,
yep,
it comes down to you either win or you lose. The ones in the middle throw them the fuck out.
It's going
to
be the start of the morning soon.
So listen, brother.
Yeah.
Hey,
okay,
21st. 21st.
I'm 21st. Me and Nails.
Okay. All right, buddy. All right,
I love you.
I love you, buddy.
Frisk that chick. I love you. Be well.
Be well. All right.
That's Lenny Dykstra. We're going to call that the greatest interview ever. God, do I love him. I mean, clearly he knows our name now. We are going to... He'll be on... basically, he's going to be on every other day.
Oh, God.
That's amazing. What day is it? The 21st. What's October 6th? So we got 2 weeks. 2 weeks to Hurricane Hurricane Lenny. He's moving across the country.
It's a Friday night.
That poor girl. What is happening? Did you hear her?
Hi. Yeah.
That woman gave up years ago. Ladies and gentlemen, AQP. That's right, AQP. We're tagging. That's a comedy term. Now it's a radio term. We're tagging the Lenny Dykstra. What happened? So this is a day after, full disclosure, this is a day after we finished the Dykstra interview that you just heard.
We needed some time off after the interview.
We did. which means there might be a whore dead in Beverly Hills. What was going on there? Hi. Say hi to
Artie.
Say hi to Artie. Hi. You know what, though? I'm going to do an experiment. Because she sounded muffled. I'm going to put a duct tape over my mouth and see what it sounds like. Say hi to Artie.
Hi. Artie, can you call 911?
What'd you say, whore? Let her better speak, Lenny. What?
Could you call 911?
Hey, bitch. Hey, bitch. What's the big deal? I said I want. I feel self-conscious, so I don't want you to have teeth either. So I did what I did.
Could you tell 911 to send somebody over with a microscope? I want to find my teeth.
Hey, bitch. Shut up. Only Dykes are. I'm going to take you to a place. I'm going to take you to a place you've never been before.
He's taking me to a place you've never been before.
Yeah, bitch. Yeah. I know you've been. I know I've been there. You never. Wait, let me get this straight. I'm Only Dykes. No. I'm Only Dykes. Hey. I'm sorry, Artie. Yeah, Lenny Dykstra. What a character with a capital K. Jesus. Sans Peter, Jesus. And of course, we can't afford the proper equipment. But it was fun talking to Lenny, and we're going to have an update. Apparently, he's going to come into town. Whenever he comes into town, apparently... I'm getting together with him. Yo, man, come on. I want to take you around. Yo, can you imagine the damage we could do? I get another pussy, you know. And you could probably, you know, be my wingman. My wingman at times. You know, my wingman. No. I don't want to be your wingman. I see what happens. You leap in the air and you hit faces.
They have to be clean, though. They have to be very clean.
You have to clean shaving. Listen, you know what's going on right now? She's shaving the enclosure. What are you talking about? She's shaving the runway. It's got to be a clean. It's got to be a clean island. It's got to be a, like your metaphors are all over the place. Like, yeah, well, I sell dreams, man. And did I mention Venture Lunch or Rebound? Oh no, I'm sorry. Rebound Capital. Rebound. Rebound Rodman. Round Mound of Rebound Finance. That's a Charles Barkley is opening up a rival mortgage company. Round Mound Rebound Finance. What's Charles Barkley? Round Mound Rebound Finance. That asshole Lenny Dykstra, fuck him. I'm the Round Mound Rebound Finance. Patrick Ewing has signed up so far. Dykstra's all mad. You motherfucker. Fuck you, man.
I thought we were Philly brothers. Yeah,
you stole my fucking idea. How'd I do that, motherfucker? Fuck you. Stole my idea, man. I'm going to tell the Rebound Mortgage guy. It's Rebound Finance, bitch. You took the exact name? No, I'm correcting you. For what? You saying I'm wrong about something? Are you even in this conversation? I know you stole my idea. You're the fucking Carlos Mencia. Mortgages. You're the fat Jew of mortgages. You motherfucker. You're the Robin Williams of mortgage finance companies. You stole my Rebound idea. And you know you can have Rebound because it's so brilliant. And you change it because you don't want to work. It's a Rebound round mound. It's a round. I'll get it. It's a round mound of Rebound finance. I don't think you're going to steal any of our guys. We have a very eclectic roster. All right, man, I'll take care. I got to go back to Artie. Tell Artie I love him. Fuck you. Hey, Artie, hey, man, thanks for hooking me up with what's his name? What's his name? Oh, yeah, the boy. The guy, the long sleeve Yankee guy. Listen, he was great to talk to. You sound terrible. Yeah, I don't know. So. I think sometimes my tooth medication. Where'd the girl go? What girl? There was a girl here. Well, I can't see you, Lenny. Oh yeah. Are we on Skype? No. That editor fruit put me on Skype sometime. He wouldn't tell me. And I didn't put my teeth in. You don't wear your teeth to my place. You had no. Well, yeah, I thought you know. I guess you know. Did you have front teeth? I think you had teeth, right? That'd be nice. Well,
I think he had teeth.
We did.
Yeah.
don't know. I've done this before. I bought people teeth who need it.
That's right, you
and
have.
They do, and they get very, very belligerent. Because they get self-conscious. My buddy needs teeth. I love him to death.
But we know if you bought Lenny teeth, he would be able, you know, he would definitely throw out a sponsorship name. The Artie Quitter podcast bought me my teeth.
Well, he would, listen, can I would tell the dentist, can you write in real little letters on each tooth? Artie Lang, Quitter podcast. Am I getting that right, Artie Quitter podcast? That's perfect. Okay, I'll get it right on it. Can you want me to overnight it? Yeah, tell him to overnight it. Okay. Could you overnight it? Huh? No. Yeah, you're right. You recognize me? Okay. You want me to stand to the left? All right. How's that? Still nothing. Or maybe, is this name ring a bell? Bill Buckner. Yeah, the baseball player, yeah. Oh, wow. I played baseball in New York. You did? Yeah, I wore number 4. Oh, are you Lou Gehrig? Who the fuck is Lou Gehrig? We have Lou Gehrig's disease? I have Lenny Dykstra's disease. Oh. I'm selling dreams. Well, you know, the first syllable of my last name is what I turn chicks into. Man, that's a bad nickname. You rethink that. You didn't realize that's a bad nickname. You want to turn them into, you know, non-dykes, you know. Oh, wow. You're fucking deep. Anyway, he's coming on the 21st. He's coming in on the 21st. I'll say it again. He's coming on the 21st. I love him.
He'll buy if you chew the food.
Yeah, he says, oh, God, that's disgusting. Imagine he's your food chewer. I need less expensive food. I need a food chewer. You thought I didn't have a lot of funny jokes. No, I know it. I know for it. So, you know, we'll get him in here. And I think there's a couple of moments I think he could be more pissed at with me and him. I think I got him. I think I said some shit out of line, quite frankly. Nothing I wouldn't tell him from the stands. You know, really dumb.
What's the meanest thing you ever yelled from the stands?
You suck, nigger.
Oh, God.
But that was at my friend's wife.
It was a different. Oh,
God. Again, you know, you know what? Here's what's funny. I'm gonna break character for a second. That joke I just told, the you suck no. Here's my issue with, and I'll say my piece. I'm gonna leave that in. But you know, a part of me, I thought about taking that out after I did it. But if you notice, Dan had, like, involuntary laughter because he has a sense of humor, which means in that context, using that word in that joke, in an this proves it's a truly uncensored show. You know, someone who has a sense of humor will laugh at that. I'll tell you why. Because it's funny. And here's why it's funny. Because that word is so insanely offensive. That's why it works in that context. So that makes the joke work. And then me saying it was at my friend's wife is a tag of it. Like, that's like, it's very funny. It's shocking. I get it. You know, it's a little cheap. I get it. But it's ballsy. It's dangerous. That's what I mean by danger. Comedy should be that. I'm not saying I'm the guy for it. I'm not saying I'm me. I mean, look, a lot of guys have documentaries made about them. Which we'll get into later. Tease Hong Kong. Major production company approached me and they said, "Art, we think you're fascinating and documentary time, baby." And Dan, am I kidding?
No,
I'm
no.
Kidding. We'll get more into that later.
We got to start working out for the Oscars.
Yep. Well, I'm not going. You go. You've been my contact.
I'll be your Susie Longfeather or whatever. What was that woman's name?
Yeah, you'll be a broad. No, you'll be an Indian chick, yeah. Wearing a feather. That was Susie. I just fucked Marlon. You know, Indians get named. The first thing they see is their name. Their daughter was Susie Blowing Marlon. Yeah, Phil, listen to that. You, when you start, when you're done sucking my cock, I'd like to ask you something. Listen, I'm really, just wait, just swallow the lamp. I got a little dribbler. Okay. I can't see your head. Could you take, all I can see is your feather going up and down. I could just see your headdress. How about the wampum? Yeah, she worked at there's a joke I had there because she worked at the post office. She gave me letterhead. I said that was good. Anyway, I want you to go and I want you to accept this award. Oh, really, Marlon? Yeah, wipe your mouth first, please. Marlon, I think you came turkey gravy. Oh. I would go home, you know, and I'd say, it's in the documentary, so you release my dog. I'll say, you know, to people, I try to get in heaven. Where are you from? Where'd you go? I thought, you know, I'm from Red Bank, New Jersey. And I say, well, yeah, what do you want to do here? What's with you? And I would look into the refrigerator, and I see all the things I like meatballs and cheese, milk. At one point, that listened to me, Marlon. Is that a Listen to Me, Marlon?
Yeah, Listen to Me, Marlon, right. From the documentary.
It's real voiceovers. He just recorded himself. He'd lost his mind in a mansion on Mulholland Drive after a while and just recorded every dumb thing that came out of his fucking head. And they put that dumb narrative to to his life, pictures of his life. And at one point, it's so gross. Well, he's listing all the stuff that he likes in the refrigerator of his mother. And he goes, I'd look in the fridge, and I always had a problem with eating. I loved eating. I'd look in the fridge, and I'd go, oh, well, that's all the things I like fish and cake and cheese and milk. Listen to that. Fish and cake. Fish and cake? I feel like a salmon and a fucking Entenmann's cake. With fish and cake. And then he goes, cheese. Who thinks of fish and cheese? Okay, let me get the fucking whitefish parm. I like the fish and cheese. The fish and the cheese. He lists the four things. They don't go together. And that's what a fat little fuck he was. Even at 16, like his fat fingers. Oh, the fish and the cheese. Oh, no, he says they're talking to me. Come on, Marlon. I love you. He's a fucking moron. Come on, Marlon. Yeah, Coppola's calling. I don't want to do it. And you could tell that's the guy that would show up on set. These poor directors, like, he rewrote the whole script for Apocalypse Now, not just the scenes he was in. Could you? It was all shot already. Could you imagine Coppola? Like, what? What are you doing? You're gonna have to reshoot this, Marlon. There's no way I'm doing it. Well, Bobby Duvall is already shooting The Great Santini. Get him back. Get this Fishburne kid back. What's he doing? He's in high school in Compton. How funny, fucking. I rewrote that whole script for him. And no gratitude. He thought he was doing him a favor. Oh, what a difficult motherfucker. In the Isle of Dr. Moreau, he's got that ice bucket on his fucking head. And it came out that was his improvise. Like, he wanted the character to do that. And John Frankenheimer, who by that, you know, had taken over for the crazy director when they lost in the woods. The director, I think they thought, got eaten by a hippo or something. And that's a great documentary. What was that documentary about the making of that? Making of Dr. Moreau. It might just be called The Making of Dr. Moreau, yeah. Yeah, my favorite is the food in the refrigerator is talking to him. Damn, Marlon, yeah. Come on, I have to let you eat me. Give me my cheese, fish and cheese. If you're eating fish and cheese at the same time, think if you're fucking eating, if you're like 15 years old, like he was when he's talking about this, you're 15, you're like in Iowa, or the fuck he was, you know, he was in Iowa, right? Or no, or somewhere. Montana. Like, where'd he go?
Well, he was in Chicago for a while, and then
did he go to high school?
He went to like Nebraska or something, wasn't it?
In high school, he went to Nebraska.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's what I'm talking about. So he's from, to me, where you go to like, from like 8th grade to 12th grade, wherever you are most of the time, to me, that's where you're kind of from, because you're, you know, kid but not a kid. But could you imagine if you're that age and you're eating, you're like a pregnant woman, you're eating fish and cheese and milk and cake together. That's disgusting. And what is Mrs. Brando cooking? Jesus, Mom. Jesus. And in the Isle of Dr. Moreau, he's got that ice bucket on his head. And you know he probably said to Frank and I, "Yeah, listen, my character is always hot." And it's because he was always hot. They're on some New Zealand island. They had him for like 20, they had him for, I think, 28 hours. And they had to shoot everything. That was his fucking deal. And he's sitting there, and he goes, "Listen, I'm hot too." His enormous calf and leg at that time, Brando, he puts it up on the chair, and Furusa Bulk is starting to turn into an animal. That's the premise. He mixes humans and animals, and Furusa Bulk's beautiful, and she's starting to turn into an animal, so she's getting like fangs. And he looks at her and goes, "Yeah, they're coming in nicely." "Yeah, you're turning nicely." And she's all upset, like, "Father, what am I?" He's their father. These animals, these overacting, like theater people in these animal costumes with a dream role. They're with their guru, Brando. "Father, what am I?" One of those fruits had this analogy that you know, he, in a way, like as for like Stella Adler acting, you know, the method acting, he was their father of that. So like that's what they used to call him father. In the animal world, like the guy turning into a cheetah. "I'm turning into a cheetah for Brando. Like, the doctor is our father, but Brando is the father of the type of acting. Like, I'm really a cheetah because of Brando. I'm really in the head of a cheetah." And I went up to Mr. Brando and I said that, and he said, you seem like an idiot." "Good, listen, I'd love to talk more about it, but Furusa Bulk is blowing me." "That's my character." Ugh. I have no proof of that. I'm just impressed. Yeah, his enormous fat leg, and he just goes, "Listen, yeah, so I checked with Frankenheimer, sweetie. Just put an ice bucket on my head." And I, "Excuse me, Mr. Brando?" "Yeah. Just don't ask any questions, you filthy whore." I'm sorry. So the old days came back. So I told Eva Marie Saint, I used to talk like that. Wonderful girl. I rolled the tight joint, if you know what I'm talking about. Put that ice on my head. And when I ask for ice, just pour it in, you know, if I see I'm getting hot. And that's in the movie. That's in the movie. He's got an ice bucket on his head. Taped to his head. And he's pouring the fucking ice. Furusa Bulk keeps pouring ice. And saying, "Father, I'm changing." And then you got Val Kilmer, who's got it's starting to get that beard cut. He's becoming fat Val Kilmer. And if you read the documentary, watch the documentary, he just wanted to do it because of Brando. But then he abandoned it because Brando was being crazy. So Val Kilmer's now doing a movie he doesn't want to do. He's got a beard gut, and he's like, he doesn't always remember his lines. His accent's going in and out, and he just wants to fuck every chick who's like... And the scenes, do you imagine being like the craft service guy or something? every day they had to get there at 3 a.m. to get in those costumes. The makeup people, it's hours of prosthetics. Sometimes they said, you know, they had to get a waiver from the union. They would never go to sleep. They would just stay in those costumes and so they wouldn't have to get redone. You know the union violation? You get overheated. They were in New Zealand. Somebody got bit by like a scorpion and died.
Wow.
One of the writers. They buried him there.
Wow.
And the director lost his mind. The director was getting a lot of pressure. Originally, Brando wanted the guy, then he didn't want the guy, blah, blah, blah. The only reason he got the part is Brando met him and liked him and said, "Yeah, give this guy the end." "You sure he seems crazy? Let's give it to him." Richards. I did Google that, Dan. I'm going to get this. Google's Isle of Dr. Moreau director, and I'll remember that.
Richard Stanley.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Yeah, well, okay. That is right. You're right. I don't know. I was trying to get that the whole time. Yeah, Richard Stanley is the guy's name. And right, okay, so the documentary might have his name in it, too.
Let me go.
But as Moreau as well. But yeah, I don't know why we're guessing.
Lost Soul, The Doomed Journey of Richard Stanley's Island of Dr. Moreau.
There you go. It's got everything in the title. I remember that. Pick that up. It's better than the movie. Oh, the movie is so fun to watch. David Herman and I wanted to do this sketch so badly, and then they decided to be too obscure because it made no money. It came out the year I started on Man TV in 95, and we all went to see it in the theater, and we laughed at like this. Oh, there's that real little, the littlest guy in the world, is in it? You know, the littlest person in the world. He's like about 14-inch midget, and he's a character. He plays like the right-hand person, right-hand assistant of Brando's character. The single funniest moment maybe in the history of film between Brando and that guy. Brando's having a dinner party, and Val Kilmer's there eating chicken, and the guy who's the main character who gets the Moreau and like is trying to get out, the English guy.
Right.
He's in one other movie that I know of in a very small part. He's in The Big Lebowski, and he plays the gay guy who's friends with what's her face's character, the daughter, the redhead. What's the redheaded actress who's in The Big Lebowski? Boogie Nights, everything. Anyway, Julia something. He plays her assistant, her gay friend. And Jeff Bridges goes over and goes, "Who's this guy, man?" And he's like, "It's Sandra Bapanale." Hi, Lebowski. How you doing, Lebowski? That guy. He's the same guy in Moreau. That's the only other movie I've ever seen him in. So the little man, this had to be improvised. They're eating at a dinner party, and Brando's holding court. He's got the ice bucket on his head, and the little man puts his head on the. He puts his fucking foot on the table and is picking at his feet. And Brando stops and goes, "Oh, don't do that! Oh, don't do that! That's terrible." And it is disgusting. It's disgusting.
I have to rewatch that.
Oh my! Oh yeah. Oh, don't do that. Let me take a leak. I'll make my point. We'll stop. Potty, podcast potties. The awards. The potties. We're gonna get awarded for this. Don't do that. So anyway, we had a sketch that David wanted to pitch called "The Studio Apartment of Dr. Moreau." Oh God, they wouldn't do it. Oh. How fucking amazing would that have been? The studio apartment of Dr. Moreau. Oh, they wouldn't let me do my character Tori Amos and Andy. Tori Amos and Andy would have been brilliant. Patton Oswalt loved it. The studio apartment of Dr. Moreau. Just jackpot. Don't do that. Don't do that. So anyway, the reason I with the N-word, I leave it in there because this is I want to be true to what I promised myself and the fans. We don't have advertising, and I ask you for a quarter a day. And what I promise you is, when you hear the show, it's going to be unbridled craziness. This is unbridled nuts. This show, and it gets nutty. It's because the only things I've censored are stuff that could be libelous lawsuit shit. I can't abide by that. And if somebody has a real personal thing they want out, of course, and they ask me for it, I always say my friends who are comics are doing me a favor. They don't get paid. I like that they come. And if they, at the end of the show, they go, "Listen, you know, I don't want that in there. I'll take it out."
Yeah.
And sometimes it's 2 hours work for Dan for something that didn't really need to be taken out. Whatever. I don't want to say exactly what Joe Mattery.
I was waiting for you to say.
Joe Mattery's had a problem with something, and I'm not going to say what he said, but let's just say if it had aired, there's a chance Joe would not have been welcomed at the rap party for Chuck Schumer's campaign. what Joe was afraid was going to happen was so out of the realm of ever happening. You're talking about so off the chart radar. Joe, I love him to death, but when Joe texts you, it's just you need something. He needs you to retweet a tweet of a retweet for a classic episode of Fixing Joe.
The look on your face when we put him on speakerphone, he said, "Just can you take that entire section out?"
Yeah, well.
And I said, "That's 45 minutes.
It has to wait." Well, I said, "Why don't you call Dan right back? Because I'm eating dinner." His wife was telling him what to do. Anyway, again. So, anyway. The joke was, what did I even get a laugh on? Why did I say the N-word? It only worked with
bad things you said at baseball games. I asked you
what's the worst thing I ever said.
Yeah.
What's the worst thing I ever said at a baseball game? Yeah. And I said, you suck. And I said, the worst thing is I said it to my mother's boyfriend or something. Or sister. And something like that. I think it was my father's girlfriend. Something like that. Like, that's, again, I'm not taking it out because that's something I can't be sued for, obviously. And that is, and I'm not, believe me, I don't think I have a racist bone in my body unless Bob Levy fucks me. But, you know, it is comedy. It's dangerous, truly edgy comedy because it's a white guy doing that. It's not edgy when a black guy does it because political correctness has ravished that. You could talk about race if you're black or Puerto Rican or whatever the fuck you are. As an eye tie, I have to watch myself. Now, the point is, I don't want to censor that because I think that is genuinely funny. And that, to me, is me going back on the promise I gave to my fans, black and white. By the way, a lot of black fans for the Artie Lang Show. I'll name three now. I'll name three right now. Right the fuck now. Pilar, right? Pilar, the black chick. She came to Caroline. She's very black. And Pilar. I'll name one. Pilar.
We lost Gerald.
Gerald, we lost for a very black reason. I'll just say that Gerald did not do much for the stereotypes there. We roasted, again, Howard was touched by the hand of God. At Sirius Satellite, we roasted a Klan member, an actual Klan member, a guy in his sheets. So Bob Levy organized it, and he got, black comics that he knew and everything. Both black comics did not make it on time. They were both late for the roast. That's funny enough. Right there, funny enough. What I'm about to tell you is my hand to God, honestly true. The reason they were late. They both got stopped with outstanding warrants. Yeah. And I think I think it was off the air, but he had the best joke. I might have gotten drunk and given him this joke. But the Klan guy said, well, are we done? Are they going to roast me from C Block at Riker? Yes. No, you know, listen. It's about honesty. And why is that joke funny? Why did Danny? And Danny's not racist either. Whatever. And listen, Moises Alou can't catch everything. But the reason you generally laugh at that is because I use the whole word. If I said, "You suck N word," "You suck African American," "You suck Italian American," "You suck by that badooby." It doesn't fucking work. It's not as funny. So I'm either not going to say it, or I'm going to censor it, or I'm not. No, I'm not. I'm not going to say that. I'm not going to waste my audience's time. And if I have the instinct, I'm going to go with it. I could cut that out. I have the power. This is taped. I could cut that out, but I'm going to leave it in. And Dan will be working at a car wash. No, I'm going to leave it in because it's just the reason it's funny is because that word is so offensive, and I'm acknowledging that it is. It's that word is startling. It is the Elvis, the Babe Ruth of racial slurs. Nothing is like it. Look, I'm Italian. People try to say guinea wop. It's that. Those are almost like funny. Those are almost like candy bar names. You know, faggot's bad too, though. That is, that stops you too.
Yeah, yeah.
That's bad, right there. When you get called that. You know, I mean, I know Dan. That's the one that really gets to them. Fruity, nothing. Right. I mean, and again, it's hang it, that's oof. I you see, I can't even really hardly say it. Like, you're mumbling. I mean, when I'm alone, but you know, God forbid I lose money on Greg Louganis time. That deserved some water. Speaking of Louganis, not bad time in there. You know, so yeah, again, I'm acknowledging it's disgustingly offensive. That's why it's funny. And to me, no harm, no foul. So genuine laugh from Dan. I bet Steve Torelli laughs, too. If I think Vinnie Monroy, Monica, and Steve Torelli will laugh, I'm leaving the joke in. How's that sound, fucker? Unless it's a lawsuit. And God forbid I get blood work back and I'm going to die, I will leave the lawsuit stuff in there. All right. So this was the tag. We needed some more time for Lenny Dykstra. Again, Lenny will be a regular on the show. I love Lenny to death. to death. I love him. And he's coming into New York on the 21st. And I'm going to try to get a story just for you guys. I'm going to do some hard-hitting investigative journalism. Again, I talked about this documentary. I get more into that coming up. And they brought up some interesting memories. And one was about, you know, my book. And you start to ask, like, I'm doing a third book. And someone asked me about what celebrities do you know, some names you know who you're close with who would write a blurb, read the book and write a blurb in the back of the book. You know, they liked the type of thing. I did it for a couple of people, but the person I was asked to do it for that I was most flattered by was the great Clarence Clemons, who used to play sax in the E Street Band. And did for, I think he started mid Wild Isn't album and all the rest until he passed away. So, you know, he's not on Greetings, but he played sax on almost everything else. And just that, you know, his solo in Trapped, first of all, you know, that when that comes up, growing up, yeah, unbelievable stuff. And it brings a tear to my eye that he's not with us anymore. The first time I saw Bruce without him, I thought he was going to stop touring. How do you find a guy? And the perfect thing against Bruce being blessed by the gods there, the perfect option, a relative of Clarence's. A nephew who, you know, looks the part. He's rock and roll. He's hip. He's like, and he can fucking wail on the saxophone. He's not his uncle, but he's getting there. And he knows the songs, obviously. And what a perfect, appropriate segue into the new era. Danny Federici went the same thing, and they got a guy who's a brilliantly crafty and knows his work and is, you know, well-respected, but low-key and respectful, and he sort of went right into the brilliant Federici's role. So he replaced those two guys and went back out on the road. And if you see him and you're a Bruce fan, there's a tribute he does to Clarence with Federici as well in the montage. That is so heartwarming. It's just done like everything else Bruce does appropriately. And it's done during 10th Avenue Freeze-Out, which is a perfect... It's got a break. The song's got a big break, and that's where he does it. There's a video tribute. And, you know, hey, man, he just yells out, big man, you know something's coming. Born and Run's got an amazing, like we said.
Jungle Land.
Jungle Land, unreal. The End of Bobby Jean. The End of Bobby Jean. Good luck, goodbye, Bobby Jean. Can you dial that up, Dan? We'll end with The End of Bobby Jean. And while you're doing that, I'll... So Clarence Clemons... Here's why you don't do drugs. Drugs directly were the problem, were the reason I did not ever get to meet the great Clarence Clemons. He wasn't doing well, and you could tell he had health issues. And I wrote a blurb for his book because his book came out in the summer of 2009. I was touring. I was all over the place. I was crazy. With stand-up, I was touring, and I was also touring to promote my book and then the... soft cover of Too Fat to Fish. Thank God I was doing very well, and they were flying me first class, and I just met and started dating Adrian, who you fans of mine would know. It's the second girl I almost gotten married to in a 10-year span. But, you know, just me and Adrian, we had a great falling in love period. It was like that part of your relationship where everything is bliss. Me and her had a blast. She made me feel so young again. I was teaching her about stuff like Bruce Springsteen, and she embraced it. And the first time we kissed was backstage at a Bruce concert during Thunder Road. Because I had to connect with my cousin there, and we were backstage after a bunch of songs and the slower songs, what people call bathroom songs, although I love them all. I had to go use the bathroom, and they let me go backstage, which was nice because in the New York area sometimes the radio fans get a little crazy. And I said, why don't you come with me? And then he starts playing Thunder Road, and Adrian knew I liked that song. She goes, oh, you want to go out? I said, no, stay here. We hadn't kissed yet. This was like the fourth time around. And like the kiss. And we sat down on one of the risers for the roadies. And a screen door slams. Mary just went. I leaned in and we had what you'd call a kiss. Like it's official type thing. It's official. She has herpes.
Oh, God.
No, of course. It was very romantic, very romantic. And every time I pass by where that happened, there in the garden, quite frankly, I get nauseous. No, it's a tear to my eye, you know. well, you know, Adrian, Dana, you know, a lot of the girls, you'll say, I love you, I hope you're doing well. But Adrian, very special, and I hope she's well. But that's what it reminds me of, you know, Thunder Road. And Bruce, it's like that, you know. And I was supposed to meet Clarence because he liked the blurb I wrote for his book. I'll get into why. I'm going to tell the story backwards because the first parts, I think, got a better ending. I couldn't make it because I was in opiate withdrawals. I was supposed to meet Clarence backstage. I had to get there on time, though, because the connection I had through Timmy, who works with Bruce and is my road manager, and some of the great people who worked with the show, and Springsteen on the road, they said, "Art, you know, he'll lot like 20 minutes. He wants to say hi because he loved what you wrote." And I had to be there about an hour before showtime. And because I was in opiate withdrawal, I couldn't make it on time. I barely got there for the second song. And I called ahead, and I had an Adrian call, you know, which is always a terrible thing to put on anybody else. I said, "You got to call him." And say, "I just can't, you know, tell him I'm sick and I might be late." You know, I couldn't see Clarence. And before I got a chance to maybe meet him again, I had, you know, fallen off the wagon big time with heroin. As you fans know, I stabbed myself 9 times and left the Stern Show. I went to a mental institution, a jail, a psych ward briefly, a couple of hell holes I got out of, and another rehab, and had to go down to Florida, to Singer Island, the place where Clarence Clemons died. I didn't realize this, was he had a house on Singer Island, outside of Tampa, and that's where my rehab was. So wow. I pick up the paper one day, and in my head I'm going, I'll get to meet Clarence again. It sucks because of drugs, I couldn't meet him, I was late, but I'll get to meet him again. And before that happened, all the other shit that I just mentioned happened in between. I'm off the show. I heard he wasn't doing that well. They were off the road, and I pick up the paper for Singer Island, which is the Tampa paper, and he's gone. And I noticed where the address was, and I asked one of the managers, he goes, "That's right there." Like, he pointed to the house. How odd. So he died before I could meet him again. And the reason I couldn't meet him, because I was in opiate withdrawal. I had to wait for a dealer to get here with dope before I could function. I got the dope. I could function. By that time, though, you know, Adrian was disgusted with me. And eventually stuff like that leads to what happens. Beautiful things walk out the door. And Dan walks in. No, you know, I couldn't resist that one. You know, so that's why I couldn't meet Clarence. But the reason he wanted to meet me was, okay, cut to 5 months earlier. It's the summer of 09. That was in the fall, right before I had my, you know, the breakdown. I'm going crazy all over the country and Canada to promote the book. And I'm at the Four Seasons in Beverly Hills, California, one of my favorite fucking hotels on the planet. The good one on Burton. And I'm with Adrian. And she came with me and accompanied me all over the country. It was a rock and roll time. And again, in that era of falling in love, it was just maddening. Like eighth grade puppy love. It was great. And I get a phone call from my buddy Frank Sebastiano. Frank worked on a couple of things with a guy named Don Rio. Don Rio is a brilliant, brilliant television comedy writer. He helped create My Wife and Kids with Damon Wayans, but he worked on a lot of Chris Rock stuff. Him and Chris Rock are tight. And Frank met him there. Got a bunch of Emmys. And if you look at a lot of shows, you'll see Don Rio. R-E-O. Italian guy, good man. And I had met him briefly through Frank. Clarence met him, I guess, through Rock, and Don Rio wrote Clarence's book with him. He was his ghostwriter. They wrote it together, like what Anthony Bowes is to me, you know. And they were looking for celebrities who were true fans of Bruce and who were good enough fans to where they really appreciated Clarence. And everyone knew that because when I get interviewed about, you know, Springsteen by Howard, I'd always bring up how much I love Clarence, and it was obvious I had appreciation of the guy that was more than the average fan. And I was on Howard every morning, so they said, if this guy writes a blurb and they talk about it, it's great promotion because he's a fan. But they did have other big names, Chris Rock being one of them. And there's always a chance you might get bumped for a bigger name. There's only room for like 5 blurbs. So they sent me the book. I read it on the road on planes and stuff, and it was so great. It just, I think it captured what Clarence is. And they asked me to write the blurb, and I said, I'd love to. I was procrastinating about it, and we're at the Four Seasons, going. So I got out of the shower, and we actually had a little lull in time, because I had to wait for Adrian to shower before we could eat, so I had about 7 hours. She looks good, and she works hard doing it. Doesn't have to work hard. I do. So I get a call reminding me from Don Rio and Frank that they knew I was in town. They said, you want to get together and go over the book? I said, I can't, but I could. I'm sorry. I procrastinated with this. Let me write it right now. So I picked up some Four Seasons stationery with my chicken scratch. I said, I got an idea. I'll call you back with it. They said, okay, we'll be here. They're in a writer's room. So what I thought of was this. Now, I know it could seem kind of corny, but I want to read it just because it didn't make it to the book is the big thing here. Other people got on the book that were more famous, so I got bumped. But Clarence knew I wrote this and tried to get the blurb on, which is why he wanted to meet me. I'll give it a shot here. I'm paraphrasing. I should have wrote this down. But basically, it said, the feeling I get when I watch Clarence Clemons slowly walk to the center stage to play the saxophone solo for Born to Run must be similar to the feeling a Yankee fan got in the 1920s when he watched Babe Ruth slowly walk from the on-deck circle to home plate at Yankee Stadium. The feeling is this. A big man was about to do something that was going to make you cheer louder than you ever had before in your life. And if I follow the words of the great Springsteen and the music of the great Clemens, and I somehow at least get to plead my case to St. Peter's about getting into heaven, he'll ask me, Art, what would you say when you got to heaven? What would you do? And I'd say very honestly, St. Pete, here's what I'd do. As soon as I got through the gate, I would drop to my weary, longshoreman, road comedian, Jersey knees, and yell out into that dark heaven abyss, big man, assist me, please.
Oh, that's great.
And I'm no poet, but that's as close I ever.
That's fantastic.
That's close I ever got to writing something that's pretty good. It's pretty good. Quite frankly, it was better than what Rock wrote. But anyway, it was touching to hear how Chris Rock truly, it meant something to him. And that's outside. Yeah. Some of the bikers by the Hudson River. Bikers by the Hudson River going over my poignant moment. Nice one, faggot. But I don't know. Now, Frank Sebastiano, the great thing about Frank is he's one of these guys. Frank is no bullshitter, especially with comedy. Frank only laughs if it's good, and he only says something's all right if it's good. And that means a compliment from him, especially in an involuntary response where he thinks something's good. It means a lot. Frank probably has an IQ north of 150. And I wrote Beerly with him, and without Frank, there is no movie. So I call Frank back, and he's there with Rio. It's just him and Rio in the room, and they got me on speaker. And I said, I can read it to you. This is what I got. And I read him what I just wrote, and there was a silence, and Frank went, wow. Like, for Frank to say that, And I knew it was pretty good. I said, well, I'd love to see it, man. He'd think, oh, it might be long, but for that, Don Rio said, it might be long, but he actually said for that they might do it. He goes, that's how much I like that. And you could tell they were sincere. I read it to Adrian, and she looked at me and she said, did you see my bracelet? No, she was teary about it. I realized, I wonder what made this whole documentary thing came up yesterday about them doing a documentary about me, and that is true. I'll get, not my idea. Some people are about to spend about $1 million or $2 million to do a full documentary about me and my life, what I've done and how I've overcome stuff and what I'm doing now. And right there, that's pretty flabbergasting.
It's flattering.
I mean, Dan,
they've done some huge actors.
Well, they like it. Well, the flattering part about it is they like interesting people.
Yeah.
They said we went, and the budget they have is they can't fool around. And they said, we think you're very interesting. And of course, that's good and bad. But we're going to do it probably. And of course, Danny's a big part of it because he's been a big part of the last decade. And I'm very proud of that. So that jarred my mind about the Clarence book. And I never really said about
it. I've never heard that story before.
Well, I never said how I fucked up about, goddamn. I was in withdrawals, man. He, in other words, it didn't make the book, and that disappointed me. And through Don Rio, Clarence said, hey, look, to me, like, I really feel bad. I said, don't tell him. I go, look, I'm in show business. Like, rejection, I'm used to it. But he wants you to know that he was blown away by what you wrote. And it wasn't about that. It was about the bigger stars. And I go, I get it. Fuck off. So it never got on the book. And so he wanted to meet me anyway to say in person how much he liked. So I'd have his autograph on everything. And I really was into that guy. Amazing big guy's guy. And I couldn't go because I was fucking sick from heroin. whatever. You know, some kids out there might be arrogant and go, well, that's not such a big deal. Well, to me, it was. They don't get it, Danny. To us, it was. They don't get why you make a sign of the cross and put your hand on Sinatra's star when you walk by his house where he was born in Hoboken. They don't get it. They don't get it. They don't get why you don't mention the Olive Garden around Sinatra's house. If I walked into an Olive Garden on the island of Guam and ordered a pasta dish, my mother in Jersey would get a pain in her kidney for no reason. What was that? And she'd ask her $1,500 a week nurse to help her up. I said I never fucking read that out loud and took some props for, you know, being able to be a little pointed. And I was able to do it, I think, because guess why? I wasn't making it up. He means that that band. Again, comics are cynical. We're very sarcastic. It's hard to be romantic about stuff. But I am romantic about very little. But two things I know I am or have been in the past. The New York Yankees, and that's wearing off. Honda Eva is all I'll say about that. Sayonara. And the music of Bruce Springsteen. The E Street Band. I've been very romantic about that in my life, and thank God. You need to have that feeling about something. You need to truly care about something. Of course, my family. I'm saying, you know, in the arts, Bruce songs have saved my life. Sitting outside Hollywood parties, missing Jersey. You know?
Me wanting to go to Jersey.
Yeah.
Sitting in Chicago.
I mean, that's really, nobody cares about that. Now, that is the amazing part about Dan's story. This is a big compliment to Bruce. Dan, a little, you know, a homosexual kid, so you're lonely.
Oh, shut up.
Think of that. Think about isolated. A rich homosexual kid.
Oh, God.
Now, of course, Danny, a kid in Chicago, those lyrics resonated. They're great songs, No matter what, but they are very, especially the early ones, man. Those first couple albums that Dan fell in love with, you know. They're very Jersey specific, a lot of it. Jersey Shore stuff, blah, blah, blah. Dan got so into it, he wanted to make a pilgrimage to Jersey and was affected by Bruce Springsteen and Rick Steves. How did you get, as from Chicago, what did you relate to in those songs early on? I'm curious.
The
we're out of time.
Okay. His I wanted to get out. I wanted to not... Right. Do the 9-to-5 job, and I you know.
Well, you didn't.
Yeah,
especially now.
Well, yeah, I'm doing 9 p.m. to 5 a.m.
That's right. Good, yeah, you're right for right now. But listen, I know the feeling too. I wanted to get out. I was one of the places you want to go to when you have that feeling is New York City, and I felt trapped. And I could see New York City from where I was. And then, of course, you know, you learn in show business, L.A., and L.A.'s across the continent, and in between is so much adventure that you want to take. That was it. You wanted out of Chicago. I get it.
No, I did not want
out of. What did you want out of? Tell me. What?
I didn't want to have a normal life.
Right.
Was
there something? Now, your old man didn't really have one, though.
No.
Right? Yeah, mine sort of did, but not an office, that's for sure. But what did you see around you? Was there adults examining? Examples that you saw that you were afraid of having 9-to-5 life, or you just saw that on TV? Like, what would you make you?
No, but most of the people around us had 9-to-5 jobs. All of our neighbors, and
you didn't want to be that,
and I didn't want to.
But what age did you figure that out? Because Springsteen, you're born in 61. Let's do the time on this.
62.
Okay, Springsteen's first album is 73. You're 11. Now, you can't possibly be that affected. Oh. What album did you first notice Bruce? And at what age?
Oh, Greetings from Asbury Park.
Yeah, but not at 11.
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
You did not.
I did.
I didn't, and I'm from Jersey. I went back and saw them when I was young, when I was like 16.
My cousin Rosie was very into music.
So at 11 years old, you got into greetings.
Yes.
And you understood what those words were.
No, I didn't understand.
Arkansas.
No, I didn't understand what any of it meant. And right. That's why it was so.
What attracted you? Like, just the sound of it.
It was the desperation of wanting to, that you wanted to. Growing up, as soon as I heard growing up, I was this is the guy for me.
I'll get that. What? So you want to marry him? What it sounds like.
I hope Bruce doesn't hear this.
I'm just, sometimes you can't hide the homicide. It's the God, Jesus, that's the guy for me. Oh, Jesus.
Well, because all my cousins,
you're ruining Springsteen.
All my cousins were listening to, at that time, they were Zeppelin and all this, the 70s.
Well, I like all that stuff too. It's classic rock. But, Bruce is unique.
Is different.
It's unique. It is.
Bruce is a lifestyle. It's a...
Like gay stuff. So it was Bruce and Rick Steves. Music was... But it's a lifestyle that's specific to Jersey. Like, that's what's impressive about you. It's talking about, and again, how you wanted to do New York radio in Jersey, and you wanted to get out of that town. I don't blame you.
I love Chicago. I loved the group Chicago.
Right.
And I knew.
I didn't have that.
I knew that Bruce had opened for them.
That was true. I know that.
And he said that he would never open for another band again because he didn't want other people to yell people's songs during. And I'm like, wow, that's like fantastic. Well, you didn't hear anyone ever do something like that.
Well, say what? What did he say?
Bruce stopped opening for Chicago midway through the tour, and in some documentary he said, I'm on stage and they're yelling 25 to 6 to 4 Saturday in the Park.
Show me the documentary. He never said that.
Yeah, he did.
Who said it?
Bruce did.
He never said it.
He did.
And in what documentary? He's never been in a documentary. So when did he say it?
It's written somewhere where he said, I didn't want to open for anyone. No.
Okay.
It's somewhere.
You play the game, Mr. Corleone. From now on, you don't contact me directly. You talk to Tim Sullivan. Anyway, all busting aside, I do admire that about Dan. That's impressive. I mean, like, it resonates. And the reason I had not, believe me, I was on the road crazy myself that summer. And when Frank and Rio called me at the Four Seasons in LA, and I said, I thought about it for the first time, and I felt bad because those guys gave me an opportunity and they needed it. I was supposed to be ready that week because they knew I was coming to California. And I was like, fuck, I forgot. And I said, let me call you back. And I could tell they were going to go, oh, you're going to throw something together. It's not going to be good. And that was, I mean, the first draft. There wasn't an erasure. Like, that came out of me. And look, Danny likes it because he's a fan. I'm not. And Frank did like it because, he was waiting for something worse. But, I understand that it's better if you're a fan. I'm not claiming I'm a poet here. I'm just saying it was even halfway decent because I really am that into this. I'm romantic about that music. And I couldn't write that way, even trying to be phony about it, even like R.E.M. or something. I mean, even great bands. Again, U2, The Who.
Petty, for sure.
Rolling fucking Stones.
Yeah.
I mean, the Rolling Stones work. From all the Jimmy Miller stuff and all the Mick Taylor stuff. It's from Beggar's Banquet to Let It Bleed to Exile on Main Street. It's unbelievable shit, those albums, for about 7 years, 5 or 7 years, ending with like maybe Goat's Head Soup and then a little bit of a lull. And then you get Some Girls, so funky. Some Girls has, Before They Make Me Run, I was listening to Some Girls the other day. Before They Make Me Run is the funkiest, one of the best sung song by Keith Richards, including Little TNA off Tattoo You, like up to the Little TNA, but that work is amazing. But it's not Springsteen, And that, I mean, to me, that's because of the Jersey thing. And now let me ask you this: did you know anybody else from Chicago, your peers, your age group, that was remotely into them like you were?
No.
So that is a unique thing. I mean, nobody.
And they were
to this day, like nobody.
Oh, then I met Sharon, and Sharon, the girl that I dated for a long time, and she was into them. But we went.
What was her male name, real name?
We went on a couple of vacations, my cousins and I, the Filato boys.
Right.
And this. And the second, the
fabulous philatelist.
You know, I made a couple of tapes,
right,
with music on it. And the second Springsteen came, turn that shit off.
Right.
That guy sucks.
Like what song?
Oh, well, Born to Run.
They didn't like
Born to Run. Didn't like Born to Run.
The Fabulous Falada Boys.
No, they didn't.
Oh, these are the guys that like Cock Robin.
Ice cream. Yes,
makes sense. But that's the point. We keep going back to Bruce. I mean, it's a common theme in my life. You can listen to this podcast. God damn, you're gonna hear it. And that brings me to plugging Bruce's book. Man, it's called Born to Run. Aptly so, and it's Bruce writing. It's so good. I'm about a quarter through. I'm taking my time. It's so good. And Norm Macdonald's book, if you're a fan of Norman comedy, you'll rattle it off in a couple hours. So great. Again, very complimentary towards me on page 172. I never got a chance to say the Clarence thing out. And a lot of people are going to say it's corny and everything. I get it. But I wanted to. I never said it out loud. I didn't make the blurb because I got bumped. I got bumped off a book. One thing on stage, I got bumped off. I've done bumps off books. But I got bumped off a book. So I wanted to get that out there. Thanks for letting me bore you. Thanks to the great Lenny Dykstra. Always great. He's coming into town the 21st. Get ready, guys. Get ready to rumble. We got it Andy. It's got no handles on him. He's a 6'5 senior out of Pascana, Texas, 238 pounds. He's got no handles on him. And he moves from north to south about as smooth as water running out of commode. You're looking live at the hills behind the Rose Bowl, where tonight the Michigan Wolverines take on the USC Trojans in the 50th granddaddy of all the Rose Bowl. What does that spell? That spells bad news for the Wolverines. We're going to let's keep texting. So thanks, Lenny. Thanks, Bruce. Don Rio, Frank. Sebastiano. The great Clarence Clemens, buddy, wherever you are. The day you died, I was across the street, man, trying to kick it.
Big man!
Assist me, please. And I love you. I figure out assist me, please rhymes with knees in that little poem. Before I say take care, brush your hair, instead of take care, brush your hair, I'll end with this. Like I said before, speaking of Clarence Clemens, here's one of the best sax solos ever is the end of this song off 1984's Born in the USA. This is... Bruce supposedly writing about, you think it's a chick. This song is supposedly about Little Steven.
It is.
Okay.
This one is.
Knowing that makes us better. Bruce howling about a broad who's a guy, like only a Jersey man could love another man, Little Steven. And at the end, the great saxophone of Clarence Clemens. This, to me, shows you his genius. So without further ado, we'll end this podcast by saying thank you, take care, brush your hair, and Bobby Jean by Bruce with Clarence at the end. Love you all.